Other health professionals, we have applications from veterinary professionals. We've also had quite a lot of applications this year from those interested in human geography. So it's really quite amazing, actually, the spectrum of students who apply and enrol on the programme. In terms of career opportunities, there's also a varied route in terms of your career path after undertaking an MSc in epidemiology. You know, obviously, some people choose to stay in academia and want to primarily pursue an academic degree. But there are an academic career, I should say, but there are plenty of opportunities out with that in industry, in charity organisations, and of course in national and international public organisations and other private organisations. So it's a bit of a challenge in that there is no sort of set defined path, but that's the beauty of it in a way. You can apply these skills in such a variety of ways and in different types of careers. So lots and lots of opportunities out there. So who is the programme for? So in terms of the entry requirements, we are looking for students who have an undergraduate degree with either an excellent or very good qualification. So this has to be equivalent to either a first class degree or a 2-1, which we call that a second upper class honours degree in the UK. There's a little bit of flexibility of this depending on how much work experience, how much relevant work experience you have and for how long. So if you are in that position of perhaps not quite meeting those qualifications, feel free to either, you know, to get in touch with us and discuss your experience and whether that would be sufficient for us to accept you on the programme. You also have to provide an academic reference and you must meet the minimum entry requirements for English language. Again, there are some exceptions where if you've already obtained a degree that's from an English speaking country or where the degree is in English and it's recognised as being from a university where we accept that as evidence of your English language skills. So in terms of online learning at the University of Edinburgh, as I say, you will have if you apply to the MSc in Epidemiology and enrol on this programme, you'll benefit from considerable expertise in the Usher Institute, where we've been running such programmes for a very long time now. So you'll benefit from courses that are structured. So in contrast to some sort of distance learning programmes, we do run the courses during a specified time point in the year. Our courses run in either 5-week or 10-week blocks, and there is a set deadline for the assignments. So it gives you that flexibility in that you can work through the material at your own pace, but it is during a defined time period. So hopefully that also helps to structure things a little bit and helps to kind of maintain that focus and motivation. So you're not tied to the class time, but you do have a bit of a schedule, which does help when you're trying to juggle other things. So you must be able to work from anywhere where you have an internet connection. Essentially, you have the same access to all university services and support as someone who is physically in Edinburgh as a student, and you have the opportunity to become part of a rich and diverse community that is interested in epidemiology and related disciplines. So, you know, we have our main sister programmes who we have many students from there joining our courses and vice versa. So, you know, it's not just within the epidemiology programme that you have the opportunity to network and connect, but you can also link in with students from the other programmes. And of course, finally, you have the opportunity to earn a degree from a world-leading university. And the status of that degree from an online programme is exactly the same. It's of equal value to our on-campus degrees. So what about if you do enrol on the programme? So if you apply and you're accepted and you enrol on the programme, the first step is that we hold an induction period at the start of the academic year in September. And this is a 3-week online induction. We provide you with lots of activities to get you started in terms of preparing for your studies. So this is an array of information that includes things such as resources and links to the library, the information services, information about digital skills and training. There's access to the student support services and the other resources throughout the university. And you essentially work through all of that information and those exercises at your own pace. We always post all of our introductions on the programme homepage, and it's a nice period to start getting to know us and to know your fellow students. And there's information if you're interested in looking at, there at the bottom, a link to the new students' guidance. So what does the year ahead look like in the epidemiology programme in year one? Well, as I say, each course is either run for 5 weeks or 10 weeks. So our courses run in what we call blocks, and there are 6 blocks in the entire academic year. So in semester one or term one, we have our first course, which is Principles of Epidemiology and Statistics. So this is a 10-week course that runs from mid-September through to early December. So that's the kind of foundation course where we teach you all about the key fundamentals and principles of epidemiology and statistics. And then after the winter break, we move into block three, where you take data analysis in R, before then going on to block four, which is intermediate epidemiology. So those first three courses are core courses. You then have a break. So we previously used to have a core course in block five, epidemiology for public health practice. But from next year, that is actually going to become an elective. So block five is your first opportunity to take an elective course that's worth 10 credits. And then we end the year with another core course, which is statistical methods for epidemiology. And it's just worth saying that with epidemiology, it's obviously it's a very specific discipline. So the timing of these courses really matter, in that there is a set order in which you have to take them. So obviously you can't do intermediate epidemiology without doing principles of epidemiology and statistics. And you can't take the statistical modelling course without having completed data analysis in R, because the statistical methods for epidemiology builds on people having already learned how to use R in the earlier course. So I'm just flagging this partly because we have some students who want to occasionally move from a different programme to our programme, and that's possible, but the sequence and the ordering of courses might mean that you have to extend the duration of your studies in order to cover all of those and to do so in the correct order. And also, if you decide to take an interruption or a break from your studies, it does mean that you have to come back in at the right time to pick up where you left off, essentially. So we're just a little bit different from courses from the other programmes, such as public health, where it's a bit easier and there's not quite the same strict order of courses. So then in year two, there are a further 2 core courses. So these are infectious disease epidemiology and research design for epidemiology. And that gives you a further 20 credits. And that leaves you 40 credits of electives. There is a very long list of elective options, which you can find on our webpage. I literally just listed some of those. We run the advanced epidemiology, the advanced statistics, and the introduction to molecular and genetic epidemiology options. And then there are a whole host of other courses that you can take from other programmes. And some of these include, for example, Foundations of Nutritional Epidemiology, which is a new course which has launched. There are courses such as Big Data Analytics, Data Types and Structures in Python and R, and other more kind of data science type courses. And then there's a range of public health courses, such as Global Health Epidemiology. There's Introduction to Qualitative Research Methods, if you fancy dabbling in something a little bit more qualitative, and courses around systematic reviews and data visualization. So there is a real mix. And as I say, you can then tailor your learning according to what you want to specialise in and what you maybe want to upskill in. And then that takes you to year three, which is the research dissertation year. So this is equivalent to sort of 60 credits of courses. So it's a 60 credit research dissertation, and you'll essentially undertake a supervised quantitative research project. We actively encourage students to take on a secondary data analysis project, but it is also possible to undertake a systematic review with meta-analysis. And as part of the research design for epidemiology core course in year two, we get you to start thinking about that, and you have the option to use the work during that course to develop a potential dissertation topic. And we give you some additional support to work on that some more before you're then assigned to a supervisor. And I guess the thing to say there is just that no student is ever left without a project. We will always make sure that everybody has a project, but we are intentionally making that very student-led, so that it gives you that experience in terms of developing a research project, a research question, and also gives you scope to maybe work on data that you already have access to or that you're particularly interested in. So what about funding and scholarships? So there are a few scholarships that are available. Unfortunately, we do have a large number of applicants, and so the success rate is not very high. There are very few places on these scholarships. So we have the Edinburgh Global Online Learning Master Scholarship, and the deadline for that is the 1st of June, so fast approaching. And then we have the Glenmore Medical Online Postgraduate Scholarship, which is also has a deadline of early June. And the Commonwealth Distance Learning Scholarship has passed. The deadline for that was March. And these scholarships are targeted at low and middle income countries. So they're intentionally supporting students from low and middle income countries to gain a place on the programme. So you can find more information about all of these on the e-learning the website, which collates all of the sort of online e-learning scholarships available. And if you haven't yet already looked at it and you want to find out a bit more about the programme, you can go to our programme website, which we have listed here. And now it's our chance to hear from you and to hopefully answer any questions that you have, whether it's about the programme, any courses, scholarships, fees, or our teaching staff.